we might just stand here among you. Can everyone hear? Is all okay? I have a great respect now for the understanding of Irma. Once I got here, I knew that there were two Irmas. There's this one, the whirlwind, and there's also the big storm that everyone remembers so well. Providence House is a really wonderful name. Now, I haven't actually been there yet, but I'm going to talk about the nature of property, and because it plays a huge role in the life of the church. Huge role. We know that many of the great saints had lots of interesting questions about property. Is there such a thing as providential? Is there some force that cares about us? Or are we just sort of grown into existence, as my modern existentialist would say, just pure chance, pure happening, and we just do the best we can? And we die, so end of the story. My degree is in German existentialism, and it was an attempt to show that some of the German thinkers at the time were off the mark. And that's a more traditional Catholic understanding of things. Makes a lot more sense than a lot of these modern existentialists, especially the nihilistic existentialists. Francis de Sales was born in the 1500s. Before there was such a thing as France. He was born in a wealthy family. It was duchy, it was called the Duchy of Savoy. And so in those days, there were religious people, and then there were the common folk. The church was made up almost entirely of professional religious people. They even had their own language, a Latin language. The common ordinary folk had no language, no common language. The aristocracy pretty much controlled everything. Francis was fortunate because his father was part of the French aristocracy. In fact, if you were to go to the little town where he was born, you could actually go to Chateau de Sales. Still exists. Great big castle. There's even a bottle of wine that you could purchase from the Chateau de Sales winery. In fact, when we moved from Allentown College upstate Francis de Sales to the Sales University, we ordered that wine for the dinner that we had at the university. So he was born into a very wealthy family. He wanted to be a priest from early on. His father was adamantly opposed to it. Absolutely not. His father decided that he would send him to the finest school of the day. The University of Paris had just been founded by a very strange religious group. They were called the Jesuits. They had just been found. So Francis is heading off to the big city of Paris. In those days, the aristocrats would always send a mentor to go along with the young people. So he had this priest who went with him off to Paris. On actually finish the schooling in Paris, he was then going to go to the University of Padua. Italy didn't exist then, but there were a lot of little duchies around, and Padua was one of the really famous universities in the early part of the 1500s. It's incredible education, as you can imagine. But in Paris, Calvin has been dead now for maybe 15 or 20 years. The Protestant Reformation is years up some way. And he goes to the Jesuit school, and he has a philosophy class. Now, I don't know if you can remember the first time you had a philosophy class, but philosophy has a unique ability to turn people's heads upside down. You get thrown out children, they don't know what to think. And sure enough, Francis is there in school, and he's been thinking hard, and the professor is presenting Calvin's understanding of predestination. Certain people are predestined for heaven. Certain people are predestined for hell. Nothing can be done about it. Well, this throws Francis into a total pit. No idea how I'm experiencing this funny bit of Christianity and Greek can understand how that works. And he had this incredible inner trauma that lasted for a couple of months. You know, just because his fears and I have written a lot of this stuff down. And he's just eating weight, couldn't sleep. Just understanding how this loving God could predestine people to go to hell. But he was pretty sure that he was one, that he was predestined for hell. And he didn't know how to get out of this bind. So on the way back to school, he started to stop at a little statue. It was called Our Lady of the Liver. A black Madonna, which was very popular in the 14th and 1500s in Europe. So every day he would stop this little statue and he would pray to me. Help me figure it out. What am I going to do? One day, he's there praying. And he gets this incredible sense of peace. It just flows into his heart. And he says, you know, I don't know how I'm going to figure this out. But God's going to take care of us. We don't have a God that's locking us into hell. We have this God who really cares about us. And I can't understand, and I don't know why I do all this stuff, but I'm just going to surrender everything to the hands of God. Stop worrying about it. And live my life according to my idea that God is this lover of humanity, intense lover of humanity, loves people beyond big imagination. And he says, and that's it. No more to think about. Well, it actually happened. He didn't think about it again. Fast forward. He becomes a priest. The Pope wants him to counteract the Calvinists who are living in this place of what is now part of France that's right across the river from Geneva. Geneva is the center of Calvinism. And he says to the Pope, okay, I'll go to that. I'll go there and I'll try to help the people to understand that this Calvinist position is simply not going to work. Doesn't make sense. I'm not going to be worried about it anymore. with all these decks on his little pony, headed up the mountain. This part of France is pretty rugged terrain. He's got his sword by his side. He's got his little friend with him, his little counselor. And he finds one of his posters on the trees in this area around Geneva. And his picture is awesome. Anyone who found him, if they brought his body in, they would be rewarded. So he said, this will be an interesting topic. So he tried to figure out, what am I going to do? How am I going to use it? Because I'm going to do it. God's problem. It's not my problem. I'm going to do the best I can to pronounce the truth of Catholic Church, announce how good God is, blah, 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 blah. I'm just going to try to do that. And he decides, I think I'll have a debate. Now, this is one of the really interesting parts of Christianity. The great Christian tradition, since the beginning, always thought that religion was a delicate combination of faith and reason. That they were those essential ingredients of our living the life of Jesus in this world. Faith and reason. Calvin, of course, has a big poster up saying, faith alone. Your human being, you have to put thought into it. You have to use your mind to argue these things, to debate these things. And so he said, I'm going to post a poster that says, I'm willing to debate this particular position of town. So anybody you want, bring me people around, let them come and listen. And whichever person that you think has made more sense, then you should lean toward that. It's not faith alone, it's faith and reason together. And I'm going to try to show that the Catholic position makes more sense. It appeals to the human ability to think in addition to believe. And so he continues his ministry there for about 4 years. He never gets to continue, but they never catch it. Now, I say all of this because this is one of the key things of the notion of divine providence. That if you believe that God is a loving God, and you use analogies to human beings, parents, or it just is reasonable to assume that God's going to try to take care of these people. He's going to look over them. He's going to be with these people. That's an essential part of the whole religion. That's what we understand about Jesus. And so divine providence becomes a key component of Francis de Sales' approach to Christianity. And the notion that God would forget us, or not care about us, makes absolutely no sense at all. All this is meaning. Now, faith and reason together. So you say to yourself, okay, how do I develop this notion of well, the Catholic tradition tells us that there are four cardinal virtues, but there are three supernatural virtues. The three supernatural virtues are not things that we can do on our own. They require the gift of the Holy Spirit. Those three supernatural virtues are faith, hope, and love. If you feel that you have faith, hope, and love, someone gave that to you. It comes as a gift, ultimately, from God. The other regular virtues is the courage, moderation, justice. Those things can be learned. You can practice those, you can develop them on your own. But if you have faith, hope, or love, that means you will get primarily from parents, from other people around you. And so you think to yourself, wow, what would allow a person who is in all kinds of difficulty, how could that person develop a sense of hope for the future? You can't send them off to the woods and say, practice hope. Work on that. The only way to do it is to give them hope. And several of you said we're going to do that. We're going to give these people a sense of hope. We're going to partner with the Holy Spirit. So you create a place like Providence now. You're doing stuff that the Holy Spirit is in charge of. If you show up there when you do something for those people, those young ladies, like the little TV kid, because you are part of the formation of the gift of hope for them. Will you get the faith for them? Will you get the sacrificial love? It comes from the Holy Spirit, but when we cooperate with the Holy Spirit, we're really helping to create that within people. And the Heavenly Father is ecstatic about that. Can you imagine when you arrive at the pearly gate, and you've been a part of Providence now? Heavenly Father would say, wow, look what you've done for my people. A horrible situation. Yes, sir. You don't have any idea where to start. So in some real sense, you are doing what Mary did for Francis Chan. He came there and prayed and said, please come. She did. She gave him that sense of hope. She gave it to him. That will allow him then to go and give it to others. So the notion of a place like Providence is that honoring God's stuff. I think everyone here should feel immensely grateful that you were inspired to do it and you actually did it. You know what I mean? But that's a good thing to do. Cooperating with the Holy Spirit. Now, I'm just going to read one little Francis of Sales has this little set of golden council, he calls them, about the household of the life of Jesus. We have this little book here for now. This is the little Providence section. God loves with intensely tender love. Those of us who are happy enough to abandon ourselves entirely to his fatherly care, letting ourselves be governed by his divine providence, without wasting time by considering if the effects of this providence will be useful, profitable, or harmful to us. We can be assured that from all that has been said to us from the fatherly and lovable heart of God, we will draw goodness and value, provided that we have placed all of our confidence in Him, and that we say willingly, I place my spirit, my soul, my body, and all that I am into your blessed hands to do with us as you wish. I recommend you holy simplicity. Look straight in front of you and not at those dangers you see in the distance. As you say, to you they look like armies, but they are only non-Christians. And while you look at them, you may take a false step. Let us be firmly resolved to serve God with our whole heart and life. Beyond that, let us have no care about tomorrow. Let us think only of living today well. When tomorrow comes, it also will be today, and we can think about it then. In all this, we must trust and be resigned to God's providence. We must make provision for enough manna for the day, and no more. Let us not doubt that God will provide more for us tomorrow, and the day after, and the day after tomorrow. Let's not waste time in willing and wishing for things, but let God arrange things. We should cast all of our care upon Him, since He cares for us. As the Apostle Peter says, and note that he says, all our care, that is, all our concern about what comes to us, from the events of our life as well as what comes to us from what we want or don't want. He shall take care for the success of things, and He wishes for us whatever is best. We must simply trust and love the Lord.
Amen.
So that's not fiery like Irma.